Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Gretchen McCulloch.
And I'm Lauren Gawn, and today we're getting enthusiastic about ways of seeing sound waves. But first, Lingcom grants are running again in 2022. These are small grants designed to help people start new projects to communicate linguistics to broader audiences.
So this year we have one $500 grant and 10 $100 startup grants, and we'll add additional grants if we end up with more patrons by the time the grant applications close. We started the Lingcom grants because a small amount of seed money would have made a huge difference to us when we were starting out, and we wanted to help there be more interesting linguistics communication in the world.
Information is on the Lingcom website, that's com with two M's. We'll put the link in our show notes, and the grants close at the end of March 2022.
Also, our most recent bonus episode was an interview chat about linguistics fiction we're reading, our favorite linguistics terminology, and what's ahead for Lingthusiasm in 2022. So you can listen to that and many, many more bonus episodes by becoming a patron at patreon.com/lingthusiasm. Learning about sounds in an intro linguistics class is kind of weird because we're already generally really good at processing sounds. Like, we're doing it right now. And one of the things that you end up having to figure out how to do is how to unlearn some of that automatic processing that you've been doing since you were a tiny kid and relearn how to process it in a more sort of awkward way so that you can actually look at what's going on there and not this very sophisticated object that your brain has made it into, which is language.
Framing it as a process of unlearning is a really nice way of putting it. I know some profs teach phonetics using sign language phonetics and hand shapes first because for non-signers, there's less for them to unlearn. But when it comes to learning speech sounds, if you've grown up with a spoken language, it really is hard to actually pay attention to what you're so used to attending to.
Yeah, and it's often sort of hard to believe. Like, what do you mean these two things that I think of as the same T sound are actually different T sounds? They seem the same to me. I'm used to thinking of them as the same, and it's sort of necessary for my understanding of this language that I'm very fluent in that I treat them the same way. But trying to figure out and unpack, like, what's actually different about them is this sort of long process that you encounter in introduction linguistics.
And part of that process is realizing that studying speech is actually studying a lot of different processes. So you're studying the way that you move your mouth or your hands around to articulate things. And you also have to study how you make sense of the signals coming into your brain and turn them into something that you understand.
And then there's also a spot where you can sort of trap some things in the middle and say, okay, before we get to what's going on in the brain when you're receiving speech sounds or when you're receiving the visuals of signs, what's going on if you sort of try to look at things with a, I don't know if a microphone is a sort of objective look at what sound are, but at least a sort of interceptive look at what sound's doing.
Yeah, you're trying to capture something physical that's traveling through the air. And for spoken languages, that's sound waves.
And the cool thing about analyzing sound waves is that if you're analyzing sort of as, okay, here's a recording or here's something we've got, you can then start trying to figure out what are other ways of representing this information rather than just like playing back the same sound to me over and over again, which is one way of doing a bit of analysis. It lets you get this very precise repetition of exactly the same thing. But also, what if you created visual versions of what the sound is, because our eyes are better at analyzing things in multiple dimensions, two or even three dimensions, whereas our ears are sort of analyzing things in kind of one linear dimension of time.
Audio recordings were a massive step forward, I have to say, when it comes to analyzing what's happening with spoken language. But as you said, it's being able to engage with that information in a different way by looking at it with your eyes rather than just playing it back with your ears really does allow us to open up and look at what is happening in that speech sound.
Yeah. And so there's a lots of different kinds of visualizations you can make of sounds. I think one of the ones that is probably pretty familiar at this point to people is sort of the idea of like seeing a waveform of sounds when it comes out. Like, I remember the first time I saw a waveform, it was something like one of those programs like Winamp that they had on early computers, where it's like, wow, wait, the line gets taller when sound is louder and it gets shorter when there's quiet. And this is now so common, like basically every podcast app, a lot of them have, you know, ways of visualizing the sound, or their logo has like a way of visualizing that. It's on SoundCloud. Like, everyone's just doing this all the time. And this was really revelatory in like the 90s.
We make use of that waveform when we're editing the podcast. So because something that's really loud and sharp has a really spiky signature on the wave file, we use claps to indicate where Claire, our editor, should maybe pay attention to if we want to mark that we're moving between parts of it. Thankfully, we do edit it out, so we don't have to listen to the claps outside of the editing. But when you work with sound files as these waveforms for a while, you get very good at spotting those kind of patterns in the visual information.
Yeah, you can spot, okay, this looks like it's going to be a person talking, and this is clearly something that's not talking. It's a, you know, sharp sound like a clap, or it's some sort of, you know, buzz of, you know, my refrigerator running or something like that.
One thing you can't see, though, is spaces between words. When it comes to a waveform, you might think the gaps in the waveform are gaps that happen between words, but we don't actually have silence between words. Speech is just this long string, and we hallucinate the gaps between words, pretty much.
I feel like I'm now extremely self-conscious of every word that's coming out of my mouth and whether I'm putting a space between them, but I'm really not. And, you know, this is partly apparent when, you know, you run words together, or you're saying something like babies will talk about like all gone as if it's all one word, which it sort of could be as the way it's treated. Or you're saying, oh, like, oh, is this compound? Should I be writing it with a space or without a space? Well, it's because the spaces are not actually pronounced. Like, the spaces are fake. They're a social construct that gets added later. And not all languages do it. It's like some orthographies don't have spaces between words.
You might be more acutely aware of this if you've recently tried to listen to speech in a language you are not at all familiar with. You suddenly realize just how much your brain is doing to segment out words when suddenly you can't figure out the segments between words.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's sort of an irony that doing this sort of analysis of sounds and waveforms is called acoustic phonetics, because when I think of acoustics, I think of like maybe an acoustic guitar, or like you go into a theater and you're like, wow, this space has really good acoustics. And that's about how good the sound is when you're not electronically amplifying it.
Yep.
Whereas this kind of acoustics is specifically generally about using some sort of technology to analyze what's going on with the sound. But acoustic just means sort of sound. So it depends on sort of which direction you're approaching acoustics from.
And so acoustic phonetics is analyzing the properties of the sound waves of speech, and not necessarily the bits of your mouth and speech stream that you're using to make those sounds happen, or the way that your brain is processing those sounds. Although obviously all three of these are important for a well-rounded understanding of how sound in language works.
But I think that's, as they say, topic for another episode. And let's stay on sound waves. So the wave part is interesting, which, you know, it can show you loudness. Mm-hmm. But there's also other things in the speech stream that make two sounds different from each other that aren't just how loud they are.
Absolutely. So I could say E and R, and I could say them with the same amount of loudness. They would look more or less the same in a waveform. But if we use another form of visualization, we can begin to see the difference between those two sounds.
Or, yeah, lots of different sounds. And the tool that linguists generally use for this sort of more elaborate thing, which looks specifically at pitch and all of the different kinds of pitches that are going on in a particular sound, is known as a spectrogram.
And spectrograms look very science. Acoustic phonetics is very science. I often talk about phonetics being essentially a form of physics, because you're studying the physical properties of sound waves, and it's spectrograms where you really get the sense of the role of physics in phonetics.
They look like the most science.
There is a lot happening in a spectrogram, and that's because there's a lot happening with the voice. A lot of really simple sounds, like a single tone note, especially an electronically generated one, is a really simple sound. There's not a lot happening in it. You can see the repetition in the wave really easily, and that is not the case for human speech. There is so much happening.
Well, and you think about this, makes sense, right? Because you can tell, you know, the difference between like me saying E and you saying E or someone else saying E. You can mm-hmm. recognize people by their voices. So every human has got a certain level of differentiation. And you can also sometimes tell other things about someone by their voice. You know, you can tell sometimes someone's accent. You can tell sometimes things about like how deep their voice is, their body shape and size and age, and sometimes, you know, where they're from. There's all these things that go into, okay, well, you're saying E and I'm saying E. And yet, how do you recognize someone on the phone?
A spectrogram is going along in time. So we read them from left to right as the time goes along. And down the bottom are the lower frequency sounds, and up the top are the higher frequency sounds.
One thing that kind of made the spectrogram make sense to me was thinking of it as like a really large and elaborate and zoomed out musical scale.
A musical scale with a lot of notes.
Yeah. So you know how normally you have like a musical staff and it's got like five lines and then they've got maybe a few notes on it that make a chord.
Mm-hmm.
And this is like, okay, imagine if you had like 1,000 lines. And actually, maybe instead of writing the lines at all, because at a scale of 1,000 lines, you can't really see anything anymore, you were only going to write the dots that are the notes?
1,000 lines and 1,000 fingers is a very long piano.
And I don't think this is necessarily a very practical piano, but I do think that it's sort of kind of what a spectrogram is, where like, if you have little teeny tiny short chords that are made up of like 50 things that are distributed along this staff somewhere, and then you can kind of hear what the difference is between them.
That's one way of thinking about it. And one thing I like about that is that, like music, you can begin to sight read a spectrogram. Certainly not with the same ease as having only a standard scale, but you can begin to see what's going on with speech and start to read a spectrogram.
But I also think like music notes are a lot more abstracted, because like you can play the same notes on a piano or a violin or something, but they would look very different mm-hmm. on a spectrogram. So it's still like you could put in the notes in a piano or the notes in a violin, someone playing a song, into a spectrogram as well, just like you can a human voice. And you could see sort of much more specific versions of what they're doing, because that's also how you can tell a violin from a piano, from a, you know, trumpet or something like that.
Do you remember when you started being trained to look at spectrograms?
I feel like my first impression of them was that they were sort of very blurry, like a lot of very blurry dots and smudges.
Mm-hmm.
And it was sort of like trying to look at some like text maybe from very far away, like without my glasses on, where I could just sort of see the impressions of the like darker gray smudges in some areas where there was more stuff going on, and the lighter smudges in other areas where there wasn't a lot going on.
So studying phonetics was a little bit like getting your spectrogram glasses.
Yeah, although much slower. Like, I didn't get to just put the glasses on and now I understand everything.
And that's absolutely true even for people who are trained to read spectrograms. So phoneticians actually have spectrogram reading competitions.
Oh my God.
When you put a group of phoneticians together. Because it is challenging even for professionals, because there's some information that is easy to extract from a spectrogram and some that is less easy to extract, or you have to kind of infer or intuit or calculate.
I'm just picturing the phoneticians at like the pub trivia night, but for spectrograms, and you sort of pass around a bunch of spectrograms on some paper and you're like, okay, figure out what this says, and like prizes.
Absolutely. And even if you're great at reading them, they can still prove challenging. I remember talking to some amazing phoneticians and they were talking about the time they had a spectrogram that had a sentence that included the word sunglasses.
Mm-hmm.
And they could not figure out this word in the spectrogram. Because it turns out the person saying it, and a lot of people, when they say the word sunglasses, that gl in the middle becomes a bit like glasses, like it's a bit breathier, and that changes how it looks in the spectrogram.
And so they were like, we can't figure out what the sound is because it doesn't look like gl.
Yeah, and so they were like, what is happening?
Hmm. And I feel like this is one of the things that's sort of different compared to writing sounds in the International Phonetic Alphabet, which is a thing that's based on how you're articulating the sounds. And so if you see a word that's written in the International Phonetic Alphabet, you can be like, okay, I can put my tongue and my lips and my other articulators in the right configuration and I can output this sound. And like, you wouldn't have a competition of like, oh, let's see who can read the IPA, because it would just be like, by the time you're a professional phonetician, you would all be scoring like 199%.
But because each spectrogram is a unique representation of a unique individual saying a unique thing,
mm-hmm.
there's all kinds of things happening in speech like that that you can begin to unpack with a spectrogram, but it's still really surprising even to people who've been reading them and dealing with phonetics for a long time.
Yeah, it's still like enough of a challenge that you can make it into a pub trivia night, which is kind of fun. I think my first spectrograms were in a textbook and like in academic papers. And so I have this preference to see them in black and white with a sort of grayscale, even though there are all the programs now that can add color to your spectrogram. And I'm like, ooh, I don't know. I feel like this is harder to read. Like I was trained on the grayscale ones.
I was trained on grayscale ones too, and I know a lot of phoneticians have a preference for those. And I remember we did our early spectrogram analysis on paper, so they were printed out ones. Some of them really old and like had been photocopied multiple times, which kind of simplified it a little bit. but yeah, I remember like physically marking out the different sounds that we could see. A lot of people now are trained to read them directly from the computer output that creates them.
Mm-hmm.
But there's definitely different preferences for different groups of researchers.
I was looking back at my old phonetics textbook just while we were preparing this episode to see what we were trained on. And they had a bunch of spectrograms in the like exercises section that had European capital cities. And they said, okay, so your job is to like figure out which of the European capital cities, you know, these seven spectrograms are, you know, is this Helsinki? Is this Stockholm? Is this Paris?
Oh, I like that because it adds a bit of constraint, which a plain spectrogram doesn't.
Exactly. So you can start being like, all right, well, Paris, let's see if one of these looks like it might begin with a P. And so it just sort of really narrows the space down enough, which makes it sort of easy enough for students to do.
So if you do find yourself reading spectrograms, there are a couple of really first steps things you can pay attention to start decoding what's happening.
Please get out your notepad in case you ever want to participate in a spectrogram reading competition at the pub near you.
I wish there were more of those. That would be great.
What should you know?
The first thing, as with the wave files, is that any gaps that you see are not the spaces between words, because we've already established speech doesn't have neat spaces between words. It's just a continual stream. Those gaps are actually what happens when you say a sound like t or p, where there's some kind of stop. And this is why these sounds are called stops sometimes, or plosives.
Because you stop the air from coming out of your mouth, and so you're making a stop. P, t, b, d, k. So these are all going to have little silence gaps that look like nothing, except it's that nothing, and then releasing it into the vowel that makes the consonant appear.
And then at the other end of things, those sounds like s and f and sh, these sounds that are long, tend to look a little bit like static. They're very fuzzy on a spectrogram.
Yeah, they look sort of like noise. They're sort of scattered around. And you can tell the difference between them because of sort of where this band of noise is. But if you just say something like f or s, it might sound like, oh, the audio file is just glitching. And all I'm hearing is static waves from a radio. I feel like a lot of metaphors that are used to introduce spectrograms are really from a slightly earlier genre of audio recording. But anyway.
They are very analog, even though we make them digitally now.
Yeah.
And it's this kind of noisy, they're called fricatives, and they have this kind of fricating buzziness to them that you can see on a spectrogram.
This is the same type of thing that you would see if you have like a microphone out in the wind and you have this sort of wind rushing across the microphone. It's going to create that same sort of noise.
And then vowels are a whole other party. They tend to be the most visually prominent thing in a spectrogram.
Yeah, if you're like, oh, whoa, there's some stuff going on here, you're like, ah, that's probably vowels, because they look like they're doing something fancy.
And they have these little bands of sound, and it's those bands that begin to tell you the difference between a vowel like R and a vowel like E.
The way vowels look on a spectrogram is something that's sort of very easy to analyze because there's lots of stuff going on there. And I think it's kind of interesting because vowels are sort of the more musical part of the speech stream. You know, it's really hard to just sort of sing like a p, p. You can beatbox a p, p, but like it's not really singy. Whereas you can sing a bunch of stuff like ah, la, and that's got a lot of this sort of musical continuity of like the notes going up and down. And that's what makes it both hard to characterize in terms of what's actually going on imprecisely inside your mouth, because there's a lot of fluidity between vowels, but also sort of easy to look at what's going on if you're looking at the acoustic signal, because they're so bright and loud and have all of this stuff going on there.
It would be remiss of us to talk about spectrograms without talking about the way they're generated.
So when I think about spectrograms, I think about one program and it's called Prot.
Yep.
I feel like this is like the classic program that I used when I was an undergrad and it's still being used. I was walking a friend through it the other day and I was like, yep, all the buttons are exactly where they were 10 years ago. And it's this program that's been around since, I think, 1991. And it comes from the Dutch word for talk.
Mm-hmm.
Linguists have just been using it. Like, this is the thing that I would expect any linguist to be using if we're talking about spectrograms.
I was trained to use Prot. I'm very fond of it. Just like you, I can still open it now. It's only had a handful of updates in the last decade or so, so I can still navigate it as well. It really is a kind of foundational piece of software that a lot of linguists who do any phonetics will encounter.
And it's really specifically well generated for doing exactly the kinds of things that linguists want to do with a sound analyzing program. You know, like the default settings are all set up for the human voice, the default, you know, sort of ways that the spectrogram is displayed, because so if you have higher or lower pitches, those sounds would be literally physically higher or lower on the diagram. And the default pitches are set up to be ones that work for the human voice. And the sort of like default settings are set up to be like, okay, here's this black and white image that's going to go really well on your paper. You're going to be able to print it off. You're not going to have to pay for like colored ink. Here's this thing that is set up to integrate really well into, I think, a linguist workflow.
And it's very easy to take for granted, but the fact that you can just record something and then try again or record lots of versions of it is very easy to do in Prot. Before Prot, the old spectrogram machines were really big and noisy, and you had one shot to say the thing that you wanted to see on a spectrogram. It was a lot more high stakes and apparently also like really smelly to print.
Oh, did you actually use those machines?
I have not used one. There was one sitting in the back of someone's office at the University of Melbourne when I was there, and it is just large and beautiful and makes me even more grateful for Prot. Because to use one of them is very high stakes.
I don't think it ever occurred to me like what people use it before Prot, because it's just, it's always been there. Like, it's a free program. I think it's open source, or at least it's, you know, anybody can download it for free if you want to download it and try it out. It's just sort of the classic program that people are using.
The old spectrogram machines were called sonographs, and they were called sonograms, and they are distantly related to today's sonographs that you get as a ultrasound. Those pictures that people have of their, like, we're having a baby, little grey fuzzy things. It's not a dissimilar aesthetic if you think about it.
Huh, I guess that's true. I was looking into, you know, the history of spectrograms and came across a blog post which we'll link to about using spectrograms to analyze bird songs.
I have never actually thought about them for anything other than human speech, but of course they would be useful for a whole bunch of other things, wouldn't they?
Right, exactly. And so there's this history of using spectrograms for bird songs, because you can sort of like grow to identify exactly what the, you know, acoustic signature of a particular bird song is. Because, like, you know, the big advantage that analyzing human sounds has is that every human comes equipped with a human vocal tract.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you describe to somebody how to make a sound, even if they don't have that in their native language, they can maybe, you know, configure their tongue and their lips and so on in the right way to make it. But, like, we don't have the vocal tracts of birds.
This is true.
Yeah, I think a non-controversial statement here. If you're trying to tell people, okay, this is what this bird song sounds like, you've got all these sorts of ways of approximating, okay, you know, maybe this is more of a cheep, maybe this is more of a peep, maybe this is more of a coo. You have these sort of onomatopoeic words. You have these ways of representing the rhythm of the sound. So if you want to say like a cuckoo makes a cuckoo, cuckoo, or a, you know, rooster makes a cock-a-doodle-doo, and that tells you some things about the rhythm and the pitch change. And then you also have, okay, maybe we can present these in a visual form, which is, you know, here's what visually this particular bird call looks like.
I guess there isn't an IPT, an international phonetic tweet-a-bit, that you can use. So spectrograms give you a nice quantifiable visual of those sounds.
And I actually went and looked, and I already had on my phone this app called BirdNet, which tries to help you identify birds based on their calls. You know, so it takes like an audio input you record on your phone, and then it tries to tell you what the bird is. And it's actually recording a spectrogram. I just hadn't noticed that it was a spectrogram because it's using different colors than I was used to.
You really are trained to read those black and white graphs, aren't you?
Yeah, I really am. And it's using a slightly different sort of sampling frequency, I think. So the lines have like different thicknesses than I'm kind of used to. I went back and looked at it, and it is just 100% a spectrogram in a slightly different, you know, visual schema.
So they're not using Prat. I wonder what the bird version of Prat would be.
I mean, so like if Prat is the Dutch word for talk,
mm-hmm.
I went and looked up the Dutch word for the sound a bird makes, and I think it would be peep. Peep.
Oh, that is so wholesome and satisfying. So now that we've talked a little bit about what spectrograms are, should we have a look at one?
Yeah. Something that was not as much the case for spectrograms when I was in school is there are now live spectrogram websites where you can just talk into the website and you get this live spectrogram of exactly what you're saying. And that's really cool.
It is a lot of fun. We have the link to the one that we're using in the show notes. There's also another one that we'll link to that has some demo files if you don't have a microphone or you don't want to be the one talking into it. It's also got some bird sounds and other animal sounds, so you can really begin to see just how distinct and recognizable human speech is compared to the acoustic information from other types of sounds.
The fun thing with this is, so we're going to talk into the spectrogram and sort of look at what we're saying, and then you can either just sort of follow along with the audio bit of that, or go to our YouTube channel and see the literal spectrogram words of what we've just said to get a sense of following along with us.
You can also follow the link and do the sounds yourself. If you try and play us into the thing, it won't look the same because this is an MP3 file as a podcast. It's compressed, which changes the way the acoustic information comes through, even though we perceive it exactly the same.
This is part of the magic of what your brain is doing.
And if you are just listening, this is going to be a short segment where you get to join in the long tradition of just listening to or participating, making strings of sounds while doing phonetics. We hope that you are in public.
For maximum embarrassment potential.
Okay, I am going to start the spectrogram timeline. And the moment that I do that, you can see it absolutely light up. This is a color one. I'm sorry, Gretchen. This isn't a black and white one.
I know I'm going to have to get used to it.
I'm sure you'll cope. It is a lot of fun. Those brighter red bits mean that something is louder or there's more acoustic intensity there. And you can see already that there are gaps and they are not the gaps between words.
And there are potentially gaps between speakers, which are probably really easy to see. When I see this going live compared to Prat, which is so like you record a sound and then you get the spectrum of that sound, I just see this moving so fast.
Indeed.
But I guess this is how fast we're talking. Like it's moving at the rate of 1 second per second. So there we are. So it's tricky right now because the sound is doing a whole bunch of stuff because we're producing full sentences. So let's do some tests with simpler sounds.
Let's start with fricatives because they have that really distinct noisy pattern that is a bit like static on television. So let's try make some basic fricative sounds.
Okay.
I hope you didn't tune in then. It would have sounded like we've gone off air.
Yeah. I think the fun thing is you can see like the s is really higher pitched and the sh is a little bit lower, but also a little bit louder, which is maybe why the shing sound lets you, you know, get someone's attention to shush them. And the f is a really kind of quieter and more dispersed s. It's really hard to go smoothly between them from one to the next.
So even though they look like static, they're all their own special flavor of static that has more information we can learn about them.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, let's look at vowels. So we can move between vowels more easily maybe than between the fricatives.
I can see those intensity bands really changing between the different vowels, which is how your brain is beginning to process the difference between something like ah and something like e.
And I think you can see the sort of pitch going on more easily. Like if I go ah, you can see that pitch go up and down. Ah, like that's just the same vowel, but the pitch changing, whereas they're going back and forth between you can see those bands kind of go in and out of existence.
And that's how acoustic phonetics can help us study things like intonation or languages that have tone differences between words.
Or, yeah, things like pitch and stress, because you can often the most stressed syllable of a word or of a phrase is going to show up really bright on a spectrogram.
I'll try alternating vowels and fricatives so you can really see the difference between the types of visual information they're giving us.
Yes.
So, sa, si, su, sa, si, su.
Sa, si, su, sa, si, su, sa, si, su, sa, si, su. You can also see what laughter looks like, which I think is really great. It's got that sort of irregular ha shape.
Very distinct there.
The pauses in the middle of laughter is what brings us to stops, which give us that bit of silence in between things. So let's leave a second of silence just to see what silence actually looks like on the spectrogram.
Because stops are made of nothing, the easiest way to see them is to put them in between some vowels. We'll put them in a little vowel sandwich so that we can see them nice and clearly.
A little vowel carrier knapsack.
A-pa, 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 a-ta, a-ta, a-ka.
A-ba, a-ka, 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 ba, 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 ba.
So many little moments of nothing that you can see in the spectrogram, and you begin to read those absences as stops once you start paying attention to what's happening with the spectrogram.
Yeah, and like the difference between silence and a stop consonant is just like what happens to the vowel when you come out of it.
So that's three basic elements of reading a spectrogram with your eyeballs.
I feel like I now, in addition to the linguistics spectrogram pub trivia night, I also want to have like a linguistics karaoke night where while you're singing, you're just seeing a spectrogram of yourself while singing the karaoke song.
Amazing and distracting.
It would be so good, right?
Visualizing sound waves with a spectrogram is a lot of fun. It is, I should admit, only the first step in doing this kind of phonetic analysis. Usually that analysis involves recording a lot more versions of the same thing or slightly different things, and then doing measures on the quantifiable elements of things like how long a sound went for, what the height of those different colored bands and frequencies were, and they start extracting those numerical values associated with it, usually across many, many recordings to arrive at averages and features that they can begin to quantify.
Yeah, the visual is really just sort of a tool to begin doing a whole bunch of numerical analysis, which is, I think, admittedly less fun to do in a podcast. But it's I think it's one of the reasons why phoneticians really care about audio quality, because you get so much different things on a spectrogram if you have, say, like, you know, sound waves being transmitted over the internet compared to something that being recorded locally. When you have all this compression going on, you don't see as bright of a bands in the parts that are doing really interesting things. So that's, you know, something that's really relevant if you're trying to do this sort of detailed acoustic analysis.
And these analyses are useful for figuring out exactly why the way that I say a word is different from the way that you say a word, Gretchen, or, you know, different people across accents or people within the same accent. And this has uses for things like speech synthesis, in order to synthesize all of the things that are happening with the voice, or at least enough of the things to sound like speech, you need to be able to figure out what those different features of the sound are. And acoustic phonetics really helps with that.
Yeah, yeah. And one thing that shows up with this is, for example, like the way you say the K sound in key versus in ka or ku is just a little bit different. And you can see that show up in the spectrogram because the consonant and the vowel interact. And so some of the really early speech synthesis sounded really choppy because they had like a k and they had like an e and they didn't have like ki and ka and ku as things that you could then combine. So you need to record way more sequences of, you know, all of the different consonant vowel pairs and triplets and combinations so that when you start synthesizing them together, it sounds a bit more natural.
And when people talk about voice fingerprinting, what voice fingerprinting is essentially doing is reading where those colored bands are for your voice, because they relate to your accent, but they also relate to your acoustic properties of your specific voice. And they match those up and see if they're close enough to acknowledge that it's you speaking.
Which, you know, obviously has potential for error, but is still kind of an interesting thing to be able to try to do.
There's lots of useful things that spectrograms can do. There are some fun things as well, yes, including manipulating them to make the most of their visual properties.
There's a really fun kind of genre of video on YouTube where they take like MIDI files of songs and they sort of play them on what they think of as, you know, like a dozen pianos that have all the notes. And if you recognize the song, you can often sort of hear some sort of weird voice as if it's singing. Whereas if you don't recognize the song, you've got nothing.
We have done this in our bonus episode on linguistic illusions. And for the songs that we knew, we could both follow along. And for the songs that we didn't know, it just becomes this absolute noise because the notes are doing that kind of where on the scale it is. But the notes of a MIDI keyboard can't do things like fricatives that have that staticky pattern. And they can't do things like the more detailed parts that help us distinguish between different stops. And that is what your brain is putting in when it recognizes the song.
But I do think it's kind of cool to think of those, you know, dozen pianos playing this song as kind of a halfway point between if you think of like the spectrogram as like 1,000 notes on a musical staff. This is like maybe 100, which is still giving you some degree of fine resolution in terms of what is actually being produced there.
Those MIDI keyboard illusions made me appreciate even more all of the things that are going on with human speech and why it has taken so much work to understand as much as we know about the human voice.
There's also some sort of weird song, right, that used spectrograms as part of the like music video for it, or as part of the song itself?
This is a genre of kind of musical play, especially in electronica, where they embed sound in the recording so that it sounds great and it sounds like a song. But when it's played into a spectrogram maker, you can actually see something visual in it. So, I think Aphex Twin are really well known for this. Around 2001 on their Window Licker album, they had a song where you saw a face and you also saw a spiral in the spectrogram if you ran a spectrogram of the song, but only the version that wasn't an MP3. This wouldn't work.
Oh, because the MP3
for modern music with MP3? Yeah.
Too low resolution, but if you got like the high res version that you ripped off your like CDs.
Yeah.
I feel like this is a very sort of Winamp thing to do. Yeah, like the technology was beginning to exist, so they're like, why not? Let's play with this.
You don't have to do it yourself. We'll link you to some videos. There are other musicians that have played around with this too. It's not the human speech part of it that's doing it. It's all computer processed and manipulated. But it's also a good indication of how the relationship between the visual information in a spectrogram and the acoustic information in the sound wave interplay.
And I think that's one of the neat things about spectrograms in general, is the sort of the history of spectrograms is them getting gradually more and more accessible as a technology.
Mm.
So you go from, okay, you need to have this big, heavy, smelly piece of equipment in a lab that produces this paper thing in one shot, to here's a website, you can click on it, you can just experiment and play with spectrograms, and you can make artistic stuff with them. And that's a really fun trajectory to see technology go down.
For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, including the real-time spectrogram viewer, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts. And you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get Kiki Booba scarves, What the Fricative t-shirts, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I tweet and blog as Superlinguo.
I can be found as at Gretchen A. McSee on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com, and my book about internet language is called Because Internet. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to over 50 bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm, or follow the links from our website. Patrons also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans and other rewards, as well as helping keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include linguistic illusions, linguistics Olympiads, and a Q&A chat about what we've been up to lately and our plans for 2022. Can't afford to pledge? That's okay too. We also really appreciate it if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone who needs a little more linguistics in their life.
Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gorn. Our senior producer is Claire Gorn. Our editorial producer is Sarah Doppiarella. Our managing producer is Liz McCullough. And our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay lingthusiastic!